down here in a stream, we have a blue freshwater shrimp. This guy right here. And actually, this is not where I found it. I found it in the main river, which is relatively large. And I just placed it here because this pool is fairly secluded and it was a little tough to catch, so I had to do it off of camera. And this stream is just coming from the hillside over here.
This here is Hancock's river prawn, and it is the only blue freshwater prawn that is found on the Osa Peninsula in Costa Rica. There are several species of freshwater prawn on this peninsula, and a couple of them are even in the same genus as this one, that genus being Macrobrachium, and this species is Macrobrachium hancocki. This is a species that is native to Nicaragua, Costa Rica, Panama, and Colombia, and it can be considered a water health indicator. This species doesn't tolerate altered water quality very well. Something that's quite interesting about this distribution is that these prawns are found on Costa Rica's Cocos Island and Ecuador's Galapagos Archipelago, which, as many of you might know, are quite far off the mainland. I'm sure by now that you've noticed this one has a small pedipalp and a large one. This is not due to regeneration. I will quickly say that this species can autotomize its limbs and regenerate them, but this difference in hand size is completely natural. The two hands serve two different purposes. The smaller one is generally used for eating, and the larger one is used for foraging and defense. These freshwater prawns wander around large rivers at night and sometimes during the day, mostly in search of dead animals.
I'm going to put it back in its main body of water now.
Tonight we are on the Osa Peninsula in Costa Rica, and we are looking for the blunt-headed tree snake. Now, admittedly, this is a fairly common species, but it's a really bizarre looking one too, so definitely worth a video. Regardless, common species also deserve some attention. I just found a couple of these Pyrophorus noctilucus beetles on this log over here. These are commonly referred to as fire beetles or headlight beetles for a very obvious reason. These two spots that they possess on their thorax are bioluminescent, and they really do glow quite brightly. In fact, this is one of the most bioluminescent insect species in the world, if we're measuring by brightness. I'm not entirely sure why they have these two spots. Perhaps it could be for breeding purposes, but I also think that it's likely that these are supposed to imitate a pair of eyes in the dark. A pair of animal eyes shining back in the dark looks pretty much how you'd expect, and I can show you a clip of that from when I was in Colombia. I was filming an ox beetle, and when I looked up, there was a couple of animals looking at me. And when you look at these headlight beetles from afar, it looks quite similar apart from the color. Since these are click beetles, they are in the family Deilelateridae, also known as elaters, and there are many other species of elaters in the world that bioluminesce, just like this one. The distribution for this species is much of Central America and the Caribbean islands. We have a blunt-headed tree snake moving along this vine here. In addition to having the name blunt-headed tree snake, these are also called fiddle-string snakes, just due to the fact that they are quite thin, as you can tell. In fact, this is one of the thinnest snakes in the Osa Peninsula, as well as all of Costa Rica. It is also one of the most common snake species in my experience. This might be the snake species that I have seen the most times in the tropics. Part of the reason that they're so thin is because they've evolved to fit an arboreal lifestyle. Many arboreal snakes can be quite thin. This slender shape that they have helps them tremendously with their hunting. The anoles out here are diurnal, and at night they tend to sleep on the tips of leaves and branches. And this snake is nocturnal and feeds primarily on those lizards. And it is their thin body that allows them to access these lizards. Along with their great upper body strength, it allows them to reach their head quite far without bending any sticks or leaves, which could wake up the lizard that they're trying to eat. Like many dipsodine snakes, these are rear-fanged and mildly venomous, which of course aids them in subduing those anole lizards. We have a large cerambycid, or longhorn beetle, sitting on this root down here. This is a species that I've encountered quite a few times. This species of longhorn beetle is Mallodon chevrolatii. And at maximum size, this can be one of the largest species of longhorn beetles on the Osa Peninsula in Costa Rica. That part about maximum size is especially important for this species, because for some reason, they vary in size an enormous amount. I've seen adults of this species that have been almost half this length, and others that were larger than this one. It doesn't even seem to be correlated to region. This variation in size seems to be true pretty much everywhere I find them. This particular one that we have is a female, and as it is with many longhorn beetles, or beetles in general, the reason I know this is because they have shorter mandibles. In this species, the mandibles are about twice as long on the males. And I have seen males of this species. You can kind of tell that, relative to the female, this one is not too large. Got a Koehler's vine snake moving through the leaves here. This one's gonna be a little tough to get down, so I'm gonna have to cut the video and start recording again. And look, it's trying to bite me. It's gaping its mouth. All right, well, I must say that we got fairly lucky with this snake here. This genus of snakes, Oxybelis, is one that I find a little bit dicey. You saw that this one was looking at me with its mouth open. This behavior is extremely typical for this genus. You can see that this one has calmed down and it's not doing that anymore. But no joke, you can hold these for hours and they'll still be just as ready to defend themselves as when you first catch them. This species is mildly venomous, so I am glad that I don't have to deal with this one. This is a really good addition to this video. The blunt-headed tree snakes that we're looking for are known for being cartoonishly long and thin, but I think they might be beat out by the species that we have here, which is Oxybelis koehleri. The two snakes do share quite a bit of similarity, but the key difference and niche that should be pointed out is that these are by far more primarily diurnal. Sometimes you can find these sleeping in the leaves or branches at night, but it's really not often that you see one moving around at this time. And speaking of that niche in relation to the blunt-headed tree snake, these two spend the majority of their waking hours looking for little lizards in the branches as their main source of prey. All right, I'm taking you to an area where the red postmen sleep at night. That is a species of butterfly. Butterflies tend not to be very reliable at night, but this alley up here seems to have these red postmen every single night. Here are our red postmen, Heliconius erato, in this somewhat open area, which I don't think is a coincidence. This is a fairly common species of butterfly around here, and this is the only area I've consistently seen one species of butterfly in every night. Otherwise, the butterflies I see generally every night are the owl butterflies, but always in different areas of the forest and likely not the same individuals, especially considering that I see various species. Up here on this fern, we have a decently sized Apilion, or harvestman. This is a species of Apilions that I've seen several times out here now, and I haven't had much luck identifying them, but this species should belong to the genus Pereiopods. Not much is known about this genus specifically, but it might be a regional endemic. Luckily, I have seen enough of these to have a few things to say. Like most Apilions in the family Ampicidae, these are almost fully terrestrial. And when they're not on the ground, they're usually only a few centimeters up, like this one that we found on the fern. But most of them don't pick plants. The majority of these that I've found off the ground have been several centimeters up tree trunks. And individuals this size seem to be adults. I've only seen one that was substantially larger than this one. I mentioned that this genus is in the family Ampicidae. There are a lot of species in that family that can be found out here, and the majority of them have spines placed somewhere on their body, like this one. Also, when these are not wandering around at night, they are hiding under ground debris during the day, under which they can actually be quite common, and several might be living together at one time. Otherwise, these are fully nocturnal. Here in this vine, we have our second blunt-headed tree snake. And often when you first see these, they're moving about, and then they freeze shortly after you shine your light on them. You've probably noticed that this snake has very large eyes. That's another one of its features that it's known for. These eyes take about 1/4 of their total head volume, and they are not unique to Imantodes cenchoa, but rather the whole genus. This is another trait of theirs that makes them such great nighttime predators. And while I'm adding on to my previous comments about this snake, I also forgot to mention that after anole lizards, this snake prefers to eat frogs and amphibian and reptile eggs. This is one of the most naturally wide-ranging species of snakes in the world. I say naturally because I want to eliminate competition from species like the flowerpot snake, which is now a cosmopolitan species. These are found in southern Mexico, all of Central America, and almost all South American countries, with the exception of Chile and Uruguay. This is the species of Imantodes that has some amount of overlap with all of the other species in this genus. As expected, since this species does have a remarkably large distribution, it also lives in an extremely wide variety of habitats, but it does have a relatively low elevation cap, that being at around 1,700 meters above sea level. Once again, as expected, this species varies a great amount over that distribution, mostly in color, but also in pattern. we've got a salamander here on this branch in a small ravine. This specific salamander, the wood-colored mushroom tongue salamander, is a species that has been on the channel quite a few times at this point. These, as you've seen, like to hang out near streams and rivers, and they are a lowland species. As it is with many of the amphibians that are in Costa Rica, the lowland species like this one tend to have wide distributions, and the rest of the biodiversity in this genus, Belida glossa, is in the highlands, mostly the cloud forests. And when I say wide distribution, I'm only referring to Costa Rica and Panama. These are the only two countries that this salamander is found in. As well as being associated with running water, like a lot of the amphibians out here are, these are more common during the rainy season. Since I've been here during the dry season, I've only been able to see three of them. This species is nocturnal and arboreal, and apparently during the day they sleep in bromeliads and other plant axils, but while I've been checking these during the day, I've only seen frogs. Just walking along the trail here, and I look up, and up here is a bat. This is a pygmy fruit-eating bat, a pretty common species around here. They have a pretty funny nose, but it's too far away. Can't show you, unfortunately. I've had to cross under a lot of bats out here. They always make me nervous. Every night that I'm out here, bats whiz past my ear at least a dozen times. Here, listen closely to the sound of a bat flying right next to my ear. It feels like every time I pass bats, they do this weird vibrate-y thing, and it looks like they're about to fly at me, as is the case with this one. Here on this mossy trunk, we have a stick insect. And this one, like many are, is quite good at disguising itself on this surface. I've seen this species before a couple times, and I had quite a bit of trouble identifying it, but I think that this is Xylospinodes gens johanssoni, which is a monotypic species. The Phasmid Species File database lists this species from Costa Rica, Panama, and Colombia, but it looks like there's a possibility that these are also found in Nicaragua. This is quite an obscure species. Unsurprisingly, it doesn't have a common name, and there really isn't all that much known about it at all. I can tell you, however, that this is a subadult. You can see that it has penultimate wings, which means that this one only needs one more molt. This is also a relatively recently described species. Its description was published in 2004. Like I said, this is some kind of moss or lichen mimic. This threw me off the first time that I saw one, because there's another genus of phasmids, Metriophasma, that's really common around here. Looks quite similar to this one, just a little more basic, like a Walmart version of Xylospinodes. Over on this tree that I'm shining down right now, there is a helmeted iguana, that is Corotophanes cristatus. Well, you can see that it is awake now. I'm going to take it down briefly and then put it back up in a few minutes. And you can tell that these are quite good at holding on. Some of you might recognize this lizard. It's a species that showed up several times in the videos that I shot in Panama. They were far easier to find in Panama than they have been here. Matter of fact, this is only the second one that I've seen since I've been here. These also live in southern Mexico, all of the Central American countries aside from El Salvador, and northwestern Colombia. As you could tell, this is a semi-arboreal species, more so during the day than at night. At night, these are practically always sleeping above the ground, since this is a diurnal species. And during the day, they also sometimes hang out above the ground, but most of their hunting takes place in the leaf litter, where they wait for insects to pass by. And apparently, something about their lifestyle, perhaps the fact that sometimes they sit still for long periods of time, causes certain fungus and plant species to grow on the scales of this lizard. Going to try to hang this one back up. Here is our third and final blunt-headed tree snake for the night. There's its head right there, and its body. Sometimes it's a good idea to walk along rivers or streams to see snakes more reliably. There are so many species that have some kind of correlation with running water, but in my personal experience, this doesn't even seem remotely true for this species. For this snake, it isn't even a neutral factor. It almost seems as if they're actively avoiding running water. I was talking about variability earlier, and I also wanted to mention that these grow 1.5 meters in length maximum, but there are certain populations of this species that cap off much shorter than that. And throughout their distribution, they are inconsistently sexually dimorphic. And what I mean by that is the external trait used to identify males is opposite between two halves of the population. Some part of the distribution of this species contains males that have shorter tails than females, and vice versa for the other part. These also have varying mating seasons and mating season lengths. Some populations mate indiscriminately throughout the year, and others can be as short as 1 month. And this mating season is tightly correlated with the rainy season in an area where a population of these is found. Cool. That is going to be all of the Fiddle-String Snakes for tonight. As always, hope you enjoyed, and thank you for watching.